To Screen Slurps, the movie review podcast where we discuss everything that is good, that is bad, and that is savage in the world of cinema. I'm Adam Meissner.
I'm Dash Gearhart, and today we have a buddy guest on the show. That's right, it's Clark Pavlik.
Ooh,
Clark Pavlik, hello. How are you today, sir?
Oh, I'm excellent. Thank you so much for having me. I'm very excited.
Dude, thanks for being on the show with us. I really appreciate it.
Oh, thank you.
Clark loves movies like Adam and me. He loves them. And Clark's a filmmaker himself. Clark, do you want to take a moment and just kind of talk about some artistic things that you like doing? And I don't know, maybe what really got you into movies and movie making originally?
Oh, that's a good question. Yeah, my name's Clark. I like to make movies. Mostly small comedic sketches, but also some short films. And yeah, honestly, that's a great question. I've been kind of thinking about that, like how I started. And I think it started in seventh grade, English class. I decided I didn't want to write any essays. And so I talked to the teacher and I was like, hey, what if I make a movie instead of writing all these essays? And she was cool with it. And so when everyone else turned in an essay for a project, I got to turn in a movie that I made with most of the classmates also there. And I think that might be where it came from, but I don't know.
That's incredibly surprising that your teacher was just totally fine with that too. I would assume that back then that the teacher would just be like, what kind of class was this too? Was it like an English class or was it a media related class?
No, yeah, nothing. It was just an English class. And I think she was just really surprised. I bet she had never heard it before and then just couldn't say no. It ended up being way more work than actually writing a paper. it would take several days with me staying up to like 3 a.m. As it does now. It was a lot more fun.
How did you make the movie though? Did you storyboard anything? Was there any pre-production or did you just gung-ho the whole thing? Did you just pick up the camera and go?
Do you have a transcript? Did you have a post-production phase? Well, you had to have at least post-production and editing.
Oh, yeah. It was on my family's Mac in the family room. But yeah, I don't think I think I just scribbled stuff down in like a notebook. And we just like, I just told my friends what to do. And then we would improvise a little bit. And some of them were fun. And some probably, I'm glad they're deleted and gone forever for no one to see.
Nice, man.
That's awesome.
Nice, nice, nice. Well, Clark, we'll go ahead and say that was canon. That is your origin story from Clark Pavlik becoming a filmmaker. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. We really appreciate that. So moving forward, now, folks, you know everything there is to know about Clark Pavlik.
It's really the only thing you need to know about Clark Pavlik. There's
really
nothing else to his story. He was never born. He never died. He just made movies, and that's it.
He was here and always here. I remember I went to Catholic school. And I remember I once asked one of my nun teachers. We had nuns for teachers. I asked one of them. I said, like, where does God come from? I was like legit asking because I wanted to know like the backstory. You know, basically like the prequel episodes for God. You know, episode 1, 2, and 3. And
you can't just go watch The Passion of the Christ or something.
I guess not. Yeah, that's a Phantom Menace in Hollywood. I guess. So like I wanted to know like you know where. Well, that's that would be the sequels or that would be the main saga. That would be A New Hope.
That's true.
You know, Jesus.
Passion of Christ would be like Empire Strikes Back, right?
Oh,
Empire
Strikes Back.
Yeah. Return of the Jedi is Easter. So that was like wondering, like, where does he come from? And then there's like, he just always was. He just always was. He was always there. I'm like, okay, geez, you say you don't know. Like, I was like wanting to dig more. I was like, yeah, I was interested, but I was so dismissed. I was like, you can just say you don't know. That's fine.
They'll actually refer you to The Last Temptation of Christ.
Yeah. anyway, with that said, Clark Pavlik, we know you're a myth, a legend. We know there's so much more to you than that story, which we loved. But we're going to get to know you more in our review of Minari. But before we get into that, we're going to get to know you in another way, a side-slurping way. no pun intended, but we're going to talk about our side slurps, which is stuff we've been reading, watching, playing, or maybe making this past week. And I'm going to direct the question first to Mr. Meisner. Mr. Adam Meisner, what have you been side slurping besides Minari?
Well, on the video game side of things, I started playing the new game Outriders on the PlayStation 4, which it's a very interesting third-person shooter game that, in my best description, I would say for all of the nerdy people out there, it's like Gears of War meets Destiny meets an even more RPG kind of game. I don't know. It just came out, and I'm trying the demo of it, and it's interesting. I just tried it out. Very interesting, but I got to try more of it. And back to the film side of things, I checked out Earth Girls Are Easy, which...
Ooh, I love that movie. Sorry. That's like one of the first movies I ever saw in my entire life, and I love it.
That was very, very funny, and I would certainly like to watch that a few more times, because that definitely blew my mind. And what a great combo of actors too, because not only Jeff Goldblum but Jim Carrey and Marlon Wayans. Yeah, what a great combo of people in a movie. And the music was so good. Music from the B-52s, Depeche Mode, and Hall & Oates all on the soundtrack. Original music, just for the movie, written for the score of Earth Girls Are Easy. And you get to see Jeff Goldblum sit down at a piano and just start whittling away. And this is obviously back in the 80s, but look where it's come to now. Now Jeff Goldblum's got his own music albums out that he's done himself. And just to see where things have started and where they have come to now...
He's in Jurassic Park, you know that?
What?
And Independence Day.
Sorry. Fantastic movie. I would certainly suggest that. That's a conversation for another day. But Earth Girls Are Easy. It was awesome. And that's the big top tiers of my past week, honestly. Other than that, you know, reality television, things like that, it's all the same for me with streaming television and all that. Yeah, that was my past week. What about you guys?
Size slurps. Well, this past week, I completed Final Fantasy 15 on the PS4. Loved it. I don't know what people's problem is. Like, I don't know why there's such fucking assholes about this game, because it was awesome. It was beautiful. It was such a... I mean, yeah, it's not for everybody. It's pretty bro-y. It's a bro road trip fantasy movie.
And it's still not fantasy Fire Emblem
game. Yeah. Yeah, but it's so good, and the battle system is so much fun. It's this hybrid of action and turn-based... Well, not really turn-based, but, like, this hybrid of, like, traditional RPG battle system with an action, almost Zelda type of battle system with so much fun. The mythology is so cool. Yes, it's basically Hamlet, but it's so much more than that. That's, like, the basic skeleton of the story. The ending was beautiful, and I'm not going to spoil it. I'm just going to tell everybody, go play Final Fantasy 15. It is so much fun. I think I'm going to probably play through it many more times in the future. But right now, what's got my attention is Final Fantasy 7 Remake on PS4. That is also awesome. I played Final Fantasy 7 back in the day, not when it first came out. I was a little too young when it first came out. It was more for like teenagers at the time. It was 1997, and I was still a little kid. I was still, I think, in elementary school, and I was too young for it, I think. But I remember going to the video store. My family and I would regularly rent videos, movies, and video games. And I remember seeing it on the shelf, because I did get a PlayStation when I was real little, and I remember seeing, like, this guy with this humongous sword, this surfboard sword. I'm like, what is that? You know, Final Fantasy 7. I never even seen the first 6 out. Like, what, 7? And, like,
and then you're like, I'm going to cosplay as Cloud now.
I thought he was super cool. I didn't know who he was, but I was like, I need a huge-ass sword like that. That was super awesome. My hair's already pretty spiky, so I guess I'll dye it blonde, which I did later, actually. That's another story. When I was blonde. Anyway, so it is basically the same story. It's revamped for the modern day, and it also has that hybrid traditional RPG battle system with action. It's so much fun. I'm like, wow, I this is the wave of the future. This is like the where JRPGs are going, this new type of battle system. It's so much fun. And it is the story. It's the same story so far anyway. I mean, have you guys played the old Final Fantasy VII? Either of you?
No, I'm not.
Well, okay, I recommend it, but go ahead and just play Remake. I never finished Final Fantasy VII, the original, and I know that makes me almost sound like a fake nerd. I feel embarrassed for saying that, but it's true. You know, I remember playing a lot, but never finishing it, and I know basically the main plot points, but I've yet to leave the slums right now with Tifa and Barrett, so... It is also beautiful to watch. The voice acting is so good, and it just feels like this, like you're playing. I know this sounds old school to say, but it really feels like it's like this movie that you're playing. It feels so good. And the music is beautiful. Nobuo Uematsu, who is basically the Beethoven of video games, and he, I once saw one of his, I guess the right word is symphony or orchestra, symphony, and he made a guest appearance. It was in Chicago, and it was all the Final Fantasy music, and he was there. He looked like he was basically dressed up as like a mage or a wizard, and it was so cool. And it was awesome. Anyway, I really recommend it. Go play Final Fantasy VII Remake as well, especially if you haven't played the old one. I mean just brand new experience for y'all. But other than that, I think that's pretty much been my slurps this past week. I've been working on Journey Punks, but I've been playing a lot of video games, a lot of Final Fantasy. Clark, what have you been slurping this past week, bud?
Let's see, man.
He's slurping a beverage right now. He's got a couple beverages. Wow.
Nice, dude.
Me? Let's see. What am I slurping?
I was dub the a righteous able slurp. Slurpee. Surf slurpee.
Oh, this is I got a Mountain Dew in honor of Minari.
Mountain water.
Mountain water. Yeah.
Sure it wasn't pee? Spoilers.
I mean, listen, that slurp I just had there was, sitting down for 2 hours on the kitchen table. So it might have been pretty similar. But I've never had pee. I wouldn't know.
Never had pee.
Never tasted it. Never even. Never mind. What about it? We went to Santa Fe for our spring break. So we flew down.
Nice.
For like 5 days. Santa Fe is wonderful. Oh my goodness. Really cute town and lots of hiking opportunities, which we indulged in while we were there. But on the plane, I was playing a lot of Stardew Valley on the Switch. Have you guys played this?
Love Stardew Valley.
No. I know so much about it, but I've not played it yet. I've heard great things.
DJ, you would like it.
You should get a DJ. Then we can all play together.
Yes, we can all have a farm.
If you guys try Fire Emblem Three Houses, I'll try Stardew Valley.
Dude, I will buy it right after we talk. Right after we finish this up, I will order
really?
It.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely.
I would lend it to you, but I only have a digital copy.
Nah, dude. I'm getting my own copy.
Good, man. Good.
I don't want to be tethered. You pick. I don't want to be tethered down.
Tell me if you pick the Black Lions, the Black Eagles, the Blue Lions, or the Golden Deer.
Team Valor.
Which house you pick.
I'm doing Team Valor. All team the way. Valor.
Well, that would be red. Then.
The red
so
one.
The Black Eagles are really red team, even though they're called Black Eagles. So, yeah.
Okay. Well, they sound like my jam. TJ, you would love it because it's like, it's a farming game.
Yeah.
But there is like a lot of, I don't know, there's like a lot of secrets you kind of start to uncover about this town. And
it's giant swords.
Not giant, not that I've found, but there are swords.
Is there spiky hair?
Yes. Yeah, good. There is.
Okay, then I'm in.
Okay. So I've been doing that. I've been doing some reading, too. I read, I read the Mike Nichols biography, Mike Nichols A Life. I was reading it, and I'm like, oh my God, I'm an old man. I've never read a biography before, and I felt like, why did I pick the Mike Nichols biography as the first one to read? I don't know. I feel like I crossed a barrier. Otherwise, that was kind of it. I mean, yeah, that kind of took me through that whole vacation there.
Nice.
Cool, dude. Well, those were some good slurps. You are worthy, sir. We are not worthy. You are worthy. And with that said, let's move on to our review of Minari.
Minari
is a 2020 American drama film written and directed by Lee Isaac Chung. It stars Steven Yeun, Han Yi-ri, Alan Kim, Noelle Kate Cho, Yoon Yu Jung, and Will Patton. A semi-autobiographical take on Chung's upbringing, the plot follows a family of South Korean immigrants who try to make it in the rural United States during the 1980s. In Minari, it had its premiere at the Sundance Film Festival back in January 26, 2020, and it won both U.S. Dramatic Grand Jury Prize and the U.S. Dramatic Audience Award. It began a one-week virtual release on December 11, 2020, and was released theatrically and via virtual cinema on February 12th, 2021 by our favorite production company, A24. At least mine.
I stand behind that. Yeah.
Yeah, yes, I would agree. I concur.
I cannot wait till they release. Side note, I cannot wait till they come out with The Green Knight starring Dev Patel.
I need to just invest in A24 clothing at this point.
Dude, yeah. Let's invest in stock. Let's get some clothing. Yeah. Let's get them as a sponsor.
Their hats are cool. Yeah. I really do want one of their hats.
Oh, awesome. Awesome hat. Awesome A24 merch. Anyway, the film received critical acclaim and many declaring it one of the best films of 2020. It earned 6 nominations at the 93rd Academy Awards, including Best Picture, Best Director, Best Actor, Steven Yeun, and Best Supporting Actress, Yoon. It also won the Golden Globe Award for Best Foreign Language Film, was nominated for its Screen Actors Guild Award for Outstanding Performance by a Cast in a Motion Picture, and earned 6 nominations at the 74th British Academy Film Awards, including Best Film Not in the English Language, even though it had English in it. Anyway, whatever. It's cool. Awesome. Awesome from Minari. Anyway, the budget was $2 million, and again, it's still COVID time, ladies and gents, so I don't judge a film. We don't judge a film by how much money it makes, but we say anyway, the box office, it has made $11 million, which is still
it's actually
awesome
good.
Because it only
it's
had $2 million
really
budget.
Good. Yeah.
Yeah. Which I wonder, like, again, I think we talked about this earlier about like another film of like the budget compared to like some of the names that are in the film, especially like Steven Yeun and Will Patton, which Will Patton caught me by surprise. I was like, who's this crazy Jesus guy? And then I'm like, dude, he saved the Earth with Bruce Willis. He was on the asteroid. Like, he was in Armageddon. He also helped coach the Titans with Denzel Washington. Steven Yeun, Will Patton, I'm like, I can only imagine like those two guys must have been really expensive and they only had $2 million. Like, wow. Like, they must have taken pay cut or something. Like that. But anyway, yes, it's made much more money than it spent making the film. And the cinematography was by Lachlan Milne, and music by Emil Mosseri, which I love the music. Music was so good. And it was really written by Lee Isaac Chung. I think I said that earlier. But anyway, yes, it was also in English, but the main language was Korean, subtitled with English subtitles. But anyway, this is the first time I watched this film. And I didn't know what I was getting into. Saul was, you know, nominated for lots of things. Saw everybody really, you know, going crazy over Steven Yeun. And I, you know, love Steven Yeun, especially, you know, Walking Dead and other things he's done. He's done this really cool short film, Naysayer. Steven Yeun's in this short film called Naysayer. Basically, it's just him. And he's on this phone in a car with his ex arguing about their child that they have together. It is so good. It's just him. He carries the whole film. It's 8 minutes long, and you can probably search Naysayer on YouTube. It's on the Omuleto channel on YouTube, and it's tremendous. This guy is an underrated actor. I'm so glad he's getting so much more praise. But anyway, what did you guys think of this movie? Adam, would you like to go first, sir?
Sure. Well, I've never seen this movie before, and I think going into this movie, I also went into this movie with a blind eye, not knowing at all what I was getting into, and I thought it was really cool. I think watching this movie at first, it sort of felt like I was watching a movie like The Farewell again at first, another A24 film, and very similar, not just because of...
it's a good movie.
Yeah, and I say that not just because, as I say, like the race or the ethnicity of The Farewell compared to this movie, but I say that because the style of the film, very family-oriented, and mm-hmm. you're just kind of watching the cycle of the film. It's a very calm sort of film. It's not this intense drama at stake. You're not watching a lot of action or something like that.
There's even comedy involved.
Yeah. And I think, too, or another sort of similar film, not necessarily comedic related, but it was like when we were watching Nomadland, you just kind of watch it for the ride, so to speak. And I liked that with this film. And I liked that this film was comedic. And I liked that this film was just kind of sit back, relax, and enjoy the ride because it's funny and you're just watching the path that these characters take. But what really got me with this movie, as I thought about it after watching the movie, it was really sort of a mind awakening experience for understanding the way that American people are reacting to the Koreans that are here in America now. They just moved to Arkansas so that the main character, Stephen Young's character, could have this farm. He wants to flourish this farm in Arkansas, and he thinks it's really going to pay out, which is creating the whole conflict of the movie. It's kind of like, what's more important, work or your family? And he's clearly thinking that work is going to pay off for the family. So if his work is successful, their family will be successful, even though he's caring much more about work than his wife through 90% of the film. But you're seeing the way that all of these Americans are reacting to his family throughout the film. And it's really just not good when you think about it. It's kind of like the way that they talk to other people and the way that the Americans react. And which really caught my attention was the first time they go to church in the movie, the way that people were talking to them and reacting to them, especially the kids. I was really just kind of mind boggled, like, damn, like the way that these people in Southern Arkansas are talking to them, and they really just don't get it because they're children. The things that they're saying, they just do not understand what they're saying because it's probably stuff that they've heard their parents say. And they're just saying it outright, thinking, oh, this is normal to say. I can call this child flat-faced, and that's normal. It's like, that's not something you say to somebody. Or the things that the girl was saying to the other, I'm trying to remember the character's name, Anne, I believe, was the young girl.
The sister?
Yeah, the sister.
Yeah.
And she's trying to say all these words in Korean, all very racially explicit terminology that she's just saying.
Yeah. The thing is, awful. Like, I didn't see, and you know me, Adam, I'm like, you know, fuck racist. You know, I'm just so fucking hate them. But the thing, I could be wrong, and if I'm wrong, somebody call me out for it. Totally willing to correct myself. It didn't feel like those two kids, the two little white kids, said it with any hate. You know what I mean?
But that's what's just interesting, though, I think.
They were just, it was especially the 80s. There was no household access to the internet. And, you know, you had your TV, which is still, I mean, especially in the 80s, just so many white people in America on TV or movies. So, like, it was brand new to these Southern kids. And all they knew was, racist stereotypes that the American media put in the ears and eyes of the American people. And they were very intrigued by them, especially that little boy. It seemed like he wanted to be David's friend, you know?
Yeah.
And it didn't really seem like they were, like, trying to put them down at all. Even though, yes, very offensive. Like, as soon as they know, their kids, as soon as they know, and their parents should tell them, like, don't do that. You know, that's bad. But I don't think they were, like, you know, like, get out of here. You know, this is America.
No.
You know, I don't think they were those type of kids, at least not yet.
I don't think either necessarily that the American child was trying to be offensive to David when he said that. Yeah, he's just saying it like, yep, this is how my family acts probably. You know, it's just kind of like that's just normal terminology for his family. Mm-hmm. But me watching it in contemporary society for us, like, mm-hmm. you don't say that. Like, we know, like, in our time now, responsibility. Like, we don't say that. Yeah. So I found that very interesting watching this movie now. Yeah. Back then, back in the times of, I think this was right around Ronald Reagan times, it's kind of like, they do.
Because he mentioned, like, Reagan's all out for the farmers to Jacob.
Yeah.
which is played by Stephen Young, if you didn't know, folks. By the way, folks, spoiler alert, if you didn't know already, we are spoiling the poop out of Minari. So, yes, and the pee out of it, too. So, yeah, just
we'll
so you
talk
know,
about
don't,
that.
Don't drink it either. Spoilers. But, yeah, hey, Clark, what did you think of this movie, bud?
I really dug this. I just finished. I just watched it. I wanted it nice and fresh in my mind. And yeah, it's very like A24 style, like kind of like The Farewell, almost like The Witch a little too, you know, where it's like, it's kind of like a slow burn. And what I love is like in the first act, they do such a good job at like immediately adding like that tension between the husband and wife. And you just like, oh, it's like, it's John and Monica. And like, oh, it's not Jacob and Monica. And it's not going to go well. And you just know it's not going to go well. And then they bring in the grandma to kind of, you know, for the whole act two. And no, I really dug it. And it was funny, but like, it was bleak too. Like, it's just, you know, yeah, everyone wants good intentions. Everyone is just trying to look out for their family. He's seeing is like, well, we came to America to, you know, to achieve what America can offer. And that is, you know, air quotes, you know, the idea that you could possibly get rich if you work hard enough and
be your boss.
Right. Yeah. And so, and they've come off this failure, as he kind of sees it, from California, and moves to where do they move again?
It's Arkansas.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and they did a good job of like, you know, really building up that tension. And yeah, man, and I cried so hard at the end too. Mm-hmm. And I'm still kind of going. I'm still kind of processing all of it right now, but it what an interesting, like, we see so many movies about, you know, this idea, right? You know, a struggling family trying to achieve the American dream, and it usually ends the same way, where it's like, well, you know, not on the cards. You just keep pushing because that's all you can do. But it was really cool to see it from this perspective of like, yeah, in that church scene when one of the newcomers stand up and shoots to the wide, and you know, they're just surrounded by these white people, and you know,
the
like,
only Asian family there. They're the only Koreans in the entire church. So,
and it's not like it's California or like somewhere cool like California, Chicago, or New York. This is fucking southern ass
right
America, you know. This is a Confederate state.
Yeah.
And it's like, ugh. Yeah. You know, I was just like, I was cringy. I'm like, no. I mean, it's still very realistic today, as I mean, here in 2021, it's still, unfortunately, horrible racism against Asian and Pacific Islander Americans. And it's not that it wouldn't be realistic, but it was nice to watch a film about Korean immigrants, Asian immigrants going after the American dream, and it not being so much about racist pain as much as it was just about trying to build a life, trying to survive, trying to keep a marriage going, trying to take care of an elder family member, trying to take care of kids, trying to take care of an invalid kid who had a bad heart, and trying to exist basically in the middle of nowhere, where the culture clash was, I mean, what seemed more foreign was here than anything else. I grew up in Ohio and parents from Ohio, and I grew up here. And it also has very southern aspects to Ohio as well, even though it's a Yankee state. It seemed like America was more of the strange place. And, you know, as Americans born, raised, and I don't know, I felt more connected, way more connected to Jacob and his family than any of the, you know, the churchgoers and I was raised Catholic, any of the guy carrying the cross. And like, I'm like, guys are weird. Yeah. Where is this place? Like, this is strange land. And I read something that it was like a criticism. Well, I mean, in general criticism about like Hollywood itself, but Lulu Lang, whose film we mentioned earlier, The Farewell, they were subject to the statement, what was it, that basically, I'll kind of paraphrase it, basically it was decisions to make American movies that feature people who don't speak English or that's not their primary language, like, we need more movies like that where this can, these, because these are Americans still, you know, even though they don't speak, we can have a foreign language film, not a foreign language, just a different language film, and have it still take place in America.
Absolutely.
And have it still be about Americans. And it's, it rings more diversity, representation, and it's powerful. And it was Viet Teng Nguyen. She's an author. I think they are an author, and a lot of other filmmakers, actors, and authors, including Daniel Dae Kim, Simu Liu, Harry Shum Jr., and Franklin Leonard, and many others. They all that criticism is right on the nose, and it's what we need. We need more films that feature just other perspectives in this huge ass country, which has people from all over the world. Which is stolen land, by the way. Anyway, that's another story. But it's refreshing. It's great because, the fish out of water seemed like the weird water was here, or the place that where we live in.
Yeah.
So that's my take on it. And it was so relatable. And because these are things that, like, I think a lot of different people can have experienced in different ways. I mean, one, just trying to, like, maybe not everybody, but especially not the 1%, but just trying to get out of poverty, you know, just trying to be okay.
Right.
Trying to be the most famous Hollywood star or whatever, not trying to be like, I'm going to be the biggest hero ever. Just to be okay.
I think that's most of the entire population right now is trying to get out of poverty and be okay. And I think that the nice thing about this movie is that it's focusing on most of the internal family problems. That pretty much is the film in a nutshell, but not everything is a downfall of a struggle. There are some good things. Yes, like David has heart problems and he has struggle breathing if he stresses himself too hard and he starts running. You know, they expose that in the beginning of the movie where he starts running and he can't breathe very well. And Yuri Han, her character Monica, is like, you want to hear your heart? And he listens to his heart, and you find out later as he starts running, he's struggling again. But then you see, as she takes him to the doctor tells her, like, oh, his heart's getting better. And it's like, well, cool. He's not going to die. Like, it's not heart failure. It's, you know, his heart's getting better. But then on the flip side of that coin, you find out in the end of the film that things turn very dark. So, I mean, the film shows two sides to everything. There's good things, there's bad things. There's good things, there's bad things. And that's kind of the nice thing about this movie, is that there's a really nice balance of ups and downs to both sides with the family.
Yeah, because totally. I mean, at the end, you don't even know if it's like, you know, he gets what, one store to take the vegetables, and that's like the big victory. And then the shed burns down, and they're not a successful farm yet. You know, they've just learned that they must persevere.
Yeah.
Yeah. And like right before that, folks, if you're having trouble, what we're talking about, it's like the end, and we just see Jacob and Monica basically break up like right before that. And it was over because Monica wants to take the kids back to California, and Jacob's like, no, I have to finish what I started. I'm going to stay here. And she basically says, like, oh, you chose this over your family. I can't do this anymore. Yeah, things are good right now, but what are you going to do when, you know, because things will go bad again. Like, well, I don't think I can handle it anymore. And he's like, okay, you know, that's it. Then it's done. And they go back. Grandma accidentally lights a shed on fire. I mean, no fault of her own, because she recently had a stroke.
Right. And she's just trying to help around.
Yeah, just trying to help. And burn the shit down with all the stock. And it was devastating. And I think, I mean, we get kind of like, it's not like, outright said, like, let's stay together, let's not get divorced. It was more of symbolic, because the following scene, we see the four of them all curling up together, sleeping like on the floor together in the house, and being very tight, very connected as a unit. Grandma's looking at them. And then we see Jacob and David go picking Minari out near the creek. And it's, I think, in my opinion, my interpretation is that, especially when Jacob thought that Monica was going to die in the burning shed, because it really had that moment of like, you know, where is she? You know, is she alive? You know, we don't know. You know, we can't hear her coughing anymore. I think there was a moment between Monica and Jacob where, like, you know, basically, you know, this, because he got her out instead of the food, the stock. The veggies. Got her out of the shed and let the shed burn. And I see it as that was symbolic for Monica to then know that Jacob would choose her and the family over the farm. So I believe they stayed together. Now, whether they stayed in Arkansas or went back to California, I don't know. But I believe whatever they did stay together as a unit. And yeah. I think on top of that, that the Minari, I'm guessing, and maybe this is a stretch, but I'm guessing that there was something about it that like was always there to then harvest and sell as a farm, even though, you know, a big part of the produce was destroyed. So I don't know. It was almost like the backbone spirit that was always there. So that was my take on it.
Because the grandma was like, it grows anywhere. And so she planted it just like really casually. She just like brought that little bag of it. And
from Korea, yeah.
Yeah.
And there's a whole flourish of it in the end when he's pulling it out.
Right.
So
yeah.
He's got a ton of it there.
Yeah. So I think with how painful, especially the ending was, I do believe it was a happy ending. I do believe that it turned out for the best.
He's running towards the grandma and just like she, because she's walking off in total shame for, you know, like, She just wants to see her family do well, and she feels so bad. She's like walking away in this daze, and the kid is just running after her. And you know, to go from making her drink his own pee to then
want a cup of piss, grandma.
Yeah. Dude, brought it up, that was so ballsy when he's like, "Hey, grandma, how does piss taste?" I was like, dude, you could have died right there.
It looks just like Mountain Dew, grandma.
Yeah.
It was also funny her like turning around like, so what, I drank a little piss, it was fun, like later on when she's trying to save him from getting beat.
I like when he corrected her when she told him that he had a broken penis, and he's like, it's not a penis, it's a ding dong.
It's a ding dong. And when his daddy, when Jacob was like, you know, you go get the stick, David, get a spanking, and then he ends up breaking it, and he's like, go get another stick outside. He ends up bringing like this like foxtail from outside that's just like very like floofy. And his grandma's really proud of him,
like, you
for
won.
Just being clever.
Or when they're playing cards too, there's so many good comedy scenes in this too.
Yeah, very much so. It was lots of smiles, lots of funny parts. And I did always, I did like the juxtaposition between like the horrors, especially the marriage between Monica and Jacob. Seemed like this like lingering, like, and they're fighting all the time, but the kids and grandma are just hilarious. And, you know, so like, it was good. I love drama and comedy mixed together. It was a good concoction, a good mix. A little bit about the development. So Chung, Lee Isaac Chung, the director of the film, had initially hoped to make an adaptation of My Antonia by Willa Cather, but found that Cather did not wish for people to make film adaptations of her works. Chung felt inspiration to make a film about his own rural upbringing. Chung went to a library and wrote down some personal memories that he used to use as a basis for the story. And Chung wrote the screenplay for Minari in 2018, shortly before taking on an instructor position at the Asia campus of the University of Utah in Incheon. Chung drew from his own childhood growing up on a farm in Arkansas. He cited Cather and Fyodor Dostoevsky as inspirations during the writing process, recalling that the former's quote, that her life really began when she stopped admiring and started remembering, as a motivation to draw on his own experiences. In an LA Times interview, Chung spoke about the challenges of drawing on his family's experiences, stating, "It was very difficult in the sense that I know that my parents are private people, and I didn't even tell them that I was making this film until I was editing in the editing room with it after I had shot it, because I was just so scared about what they would say." Chung used English as his medium for writing the script, and the lines spoken in Korea were translated into Korean. These parts were translated into colloquial Korean by translator Hong Yul, talking to director and actors. In early 2019, Christina Oh and Plan B Entertainment signed on as producers of the film. Oh later brought on A24 to distribute the film. So a little backstory on Chung's development on Minari.
Nothing like a semi-autobiographical film about being Korean on a farm.
Yeah, I'm guessing he was David. I'm curious if like he had any heart problems when he was little. But then later in July 2018, it was announced that Steven Young, Han Yiri, Young Yu Jung, Will Patton, and Scott Hayes had joined the cast of the film. Will Patton played a weird dude.
That was so great. I love Stephen Young's reactions too. Just like,
you crazy, okay, man.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Okay. That was, yeah. Okay. Yeah, man. That was also, I forgot how funny those moments were with, at first
he
I was
like
really
three or
cautious.
Four different times too. Just, okay.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I was almost worried. I was like, is Will Patton going to like kill his whole family or something? I was like, those glasses are thick. I don't know.
I know. And he was like, I fought in the Korean War. And
yeah, I was like, are you
grandma,
racist? Yeah.
With the grandma's husband died in the Korean War. And so it was just like, oh no, I thought something bad was going to happen. And you end up liking the guy that carries a cross around a dirt road every Sunday.
Yeah, he ends up being really, even when Jacob is like, you know, really frustrated and he's like breaking stuff and he's like, it's going to be okay. You know, like he was just trying to like comfort him. Yeah. And even when he's being, you know, super angry, and I was like, oh, maybe he's nice. He's praised really strangely, but he's nice.
Yeah, I love the actor. He made such a great choice when he grabbed his shoulder and he's like, it's going to be okay. I love what he like.
Yeah.
He put out his hand and he like hesitates just like a little bit. And it just like, and then he grabs him. It's like he was nervous to like console him. And it was just, I don't know, it was just such a great little choice that really, I really humanized him.
And it's
me.
Really Will Patton. That's like his thing too. I mean, if you ever seen Armageddon or Remember the Titans, you know, I mean, he's just always like, you want him on your side. You want that. Yeah. You want that guy beside you to like, you know, it's gonna be okay. You know, like especially when Bruce Willis is doing his final speech and on the asteroid, and you know, he's just, I don't know, like there's something about the calmness in his voice that makes you feel like, hey, crazy shit's happening, but this guy makes me feel like
we'll be sure to give chill. Will Patton a call after this. So
yeah, man. Will Patton, I think Will Patton is, yeah, especially for people with anxiety like myself, like it's just like, hey, I think you can be okay. Like, yeah. So I if I had a farm, I would hire that guy. Even though he carries
the crazy Minari Will Patton.
Yeah, he's super crazy praying style, but okay. Anyway, also, what was with that whole finding water thing with the stick? Like, I never heard of that before.
I'd never heard of that either, but Laura was telling me that's like a normal thing. And she's like, oh yeah, we've found water before using coat hangers. And if you walk by water with two coat hangers and like bent, then they'll cross over when you're near groundwater. And I'm like, okay, I don't know what you are talking about.
I don't know what science that comes from.
Oh, geez.
Or if you use a stick, then the stick will just point to the ground when you walk over groundwater. And yeah, I don't know who knows this or who's done it. I had never heard of that.
Yeah, I come from farmland USA in Ohio. That's where I grew up. And I never heard of anybody doing that trick ever. But okay, I guess. Okay. Yeah, sure. I get, hey, if it works, then cool. anyway, yeah, the film, they filmed it back in July 2019 in Tulsa, Oklahoma. That's where principal photography took place. And it lasted for 25 days in order to make the deadline. For Sundance editor, Yeri Yoon edited the film as production took place. So very much similar to like a 40-hour film festival in a way, editing while you're shooting. During filming, Han and Yoon Jung lived in the same Airbnb. As Yoon Jung was unknown in the United States, unlike in South Korea, where she was known as a known celebrity and was given a lot of deference, she felt she needed to show her acting skills with a new audience. Yoon Jung previously lived in the United States and used that experience in her performance. Lee Isaac Chung told her not to play Soon Jung in the way that Lee Chung's grandmother was, a movie welcomed by Yoon Jung. Lee Isaac Chung also took Yoon Jung's suggestion, including one where her character takes money from a church offering, even though Lee Isaac Chung's religious background gave him some hesitation about including that idea. According to Yoon Jung, Lee Isaac Chung intended for Soon Ja to be alive at the end of the story. Did she die, Dylan?
No. They don't actually show her dying.
Yeah, I thought she was alive. Implied. She's like staring at the family, very like just kind of blank stare, not moving. And when they were all sleeping on the floor in the living room after the fire,
are they trying to imply that that's like a dead stare?
I don't know. That's interesting. Anyway,
I mean.
But anyway, I love that part where she took money from.
Yeah. Well, they put in a ridiculous amount. You would have put $100 into a Southern church.
And she took it back. Yeah.
It's like, and she was like nervous about the tractor and she's going to throw in $100 a week to church.
That's well, trying to make friends. So
it's quite a bit for Jesus.
Yeah, Jesus. I love that part when they drive by Will Patton's character when he was carrying a cross. Yeah. And then Jacob's like, well, yeah, he's like looking at his wife. He's like, you like Jesus? There you go. There's a pal.
Yeah, you like Jesus too.
You like Jesus too. So.
Well, he was clearly doing that every week too.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Hey, yeah. Gotta be a good workout. Gotta be a great workout. No kidding. You know, that giant cross.
I think I might start trying that in Chicago here.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
No one's going to mind on the city streets.
Oh, yeah. crossing anyway, Broadway.
Yeah, exactly.
That's what we'll call it, crossing Broadway.
Broadway with Clark Pavlik. Clark and his cross. Initially, the film was set for release in limited release on December 11, 2020, before slowly expanding to a wide audience February 12, 2021. However, the theatrical release was curtailed due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Fuck you, COVID. It was released in select theaters and virtual cinemas for 1 week on December 11, 2020. I paid $20 to rent this film, but it was $20 well spent. I'm glad that money went to help the film out, and I don't regret it. It was good. And with that said, I hope this is not the norm. I hope movies return to the theaters once everybody gets vaccinated, and I do not believe that films could just go straight to on demand. I love the access, especially doing this podcast with you, Adam. I love that we can just watch any movie, anytime, anywhere. But I miss the cinematic experience so badly. I think the last time was when you and I did social distance, like with a mask on. I think we saw Tenet. I think that was the last time, which is quite a while ago.
Dang, yeah, that's a while ago.
Tenet. Tenet. I'm gonna say Tenet backwards. Tenet.
Random side note.
Your mind.
Nice side one, note, Chris.
Good lord. I haven't seen all the Harry Potter films, and I was just watching Chamber of Secrets, and what's his face from fucking Tenet? The antagonist is the teacher in Chamber of Secrets. The guy who loses his memory when he goes down to the chamber.
Oh, Lockhart?
Yeah.
Gilderoy Lockhart. Dude, yeah. That guy is an awesome actor. Yeah.
It's Kenneth Branagh.
Yeah. He awesome Shakespearean actor. He's great. Yeah.
My Shakespeare teacher in college went to the same school as he did in England. She said that she didn't get to like rub elbows with him much, but he was like a senior, like last year when she was a first year. So it was, but yeah, she got to, you know, from a distance see him,
nice.
Which is cool. And that dude's awesome. Did the first Thor movie, directed it, and great Shakespearean actor, and also very scary in Tenet. Tenet. Anyway, the performances of Stephen Young and Yoo Jung garnered critical acclaim, and they both received Academy Award nominations for Best Actor and Best Supporting Actress, respectively. According to Rotten Tomatoes, it got a 98% of 272 Ooh. Critic reviews. And Minari were positive. The average rating of 8.7 out of 10. And the site's critics' consensus reads, led by arresting performances from Stephen Young and Yuri Han, Minari offers an intimate, heart-wrenching portrait of family and assimilation in 1980s America. Metacritic assigned the film a weighted score of 89 out of 100 based on 49 critics, indicating universal acclaim. A.O. Scott of the New York Times gave the film a positive review, writing, "Minari is modest, specific, and thrifty. Like the lives it surveys, there's nothing small about it, though, because it operates at a true scale of life." Nicholas Barber at the BBC rated the film 5 out of 5, stating that sensitively written and acted, beautifully shot, and with a charming, sparingly used score. Yeah, I love the score. Minari is so engaging that it's easy to forget how radical it is. And for The Guardian, Benjamin Lee at The Guardian also rated the film, 4 out of 5, stating, "The autobiographical story of a Korean-American family trying to sustain a farm in rural Arkansas has deservedly become the festival's most universally loved film." And that was on the Sundance Film Festival. Minari appeared on 68 critics year and top 10 lists, including first place on 5-year end lists and second place on a 9-year end list. So yeah, it is whooping ass
as it should
around.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah, as it should. It's triumphantly kicking ass in the festival circuit.
And I mean, if it's not kicking the ass, then it should be looking at it, because who doesn't want to look at chicken butts?
Yeah. Looking at those chicken butts and serving up some mountain water piss. To the haters.
I will never call Mountain Dew anymore. It's just mountain water.
Yeah, mountain water.
Yeah. Kid piss. He did such a good job at like picking that job that they, because like they take the chickens, they take the butt of the chicken, they dip it in that like water or the milk or whatever, and then
milk.
Milk. That would be awful.
Dip it in piss. Dip it in mountain water.
Yeah, some flour and some milk, and then you check the sex, and then you burn the males.
I know.
That was pretty grim.
Gosh. That was a realization that I never really thought about before.
Yeah, I'm like, me either. Shit. Like, whole.
As David's like, what is that for? It's like, that's where the male chickens go. Like,
so do we not eat male chickens? Do we only eat female chickens? Is that what?
I don't know.
That's what it sounds like.
I was like, don't they become roosters? You know, don't they?
You would only need like one or two roosters or something at a time for like, or a very small amount.
Yeah.
You could just have one rooster to just impregnate a ton of chickens. All of those chickens could then lay eggs and just lay more chickens.
I sort of see why they don't just make them meat later too. Yeah. I mean, like, just let them live lives, and at the end of their lives, humanely put them out of, you know, take them out and then serve them up as meat. Yeah. I mean, I don't understand like why they had to be killed when they're babies. Like,
tossed into a fire.
Yeah. Jesus Christ. Like, this is so morbid and inhumane.
I guess,
like,
too, looking back on another television show, BoJack Horseman, when they have the rooster farm in, or the chicken farm, I should say, in BoJack Horseman, none of the chickens that they save from there are roosters. They just have the rooster that runs the entire farm, and then all the chickens that get set free are all hens.
Hmm.
Wow. I guess it's true. this episode goes out to all the fallen male chicken soldiers.
We could have ate you. You know what? I would have eaten you, male chickens.
That's really nice, DJ. That's really nice.
I would have eaten you.
I'm gonna keep eating the chicken that I've been eating.
I would have eaten
good,
you.
So
for all of you would, fallen male chickens, I would have eaten you.
You had a place on my plate, I would just sort of say. After you've lived a full life and were, you know, killed painlessly in your sleep, and it was no pain, none of that headless chicken running around thing, none of that, you know, horror movie type.
Talking about chickens running around, now you're going to make me want to go watch Chicken Run, listen to Mel Gibson be an awful man.
I had a chicken burrito for dinner.
There you go.
Yeah, in Chipotle.
Ask for male chicken.
I was like, why don't you have male chickens, huh?
Yeah.
I hope that method dissolved in the 80s. Because this was a period piece in the 80s, and I hope that it doesn't happen. I hope the meat industry treats the animals kindly, because animals have feelings too, even though we eat them.
Yep.
I was wondering, because like it's such a, like it's if it was like a grim metaphor, because I saw that he wrote this movie, like you said, right before taking that English job, and he was taking that English job to like support his family, and this was I'll write one last script, you know?
Yeah.
And it looks like he had done a few movies, but nothing to this extent, like with the budget and A24 back and all that. He was like, I wonder if at the time when he finished the script and he was like, okay, well, I'm done and I want to go to this English job, like if he felt, you know, like that his shed had burned down, and if it was like left open-ended because he didn't know what was going to come next in his life. You know, he just knew that he had his family and his veggies had been lost.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, he didn't do a film for 5 years before this. He didn't do one since 2015. And it was 3 years before that where he did a film called Abigail Harm. 2 years before that, 2010, he did Lucky Life. 2007, he did Mun Yuren Gabo, 2007. And then he did three shorts before that.
Well, he's going to do a live action version of
Your
Name.
With Emily B. Gordon, Kumail Nanjiani's life. You're absolutely right about that. That's also Mark Webb is involved in that too. Mark Webb, who did 500 Days of Summer, is a co-director on it. Him and Lee Isaac Chung are listed as both directors.
Huh, that'll be interesting. So
that'll be really cool.
That seems cool. Yeah. Dude, anime is going to be the next. I'm just going to say, like, anime is
it's
like
gonna be the
next
new Marvel film.
Yeah, dude, it is, because like they're going to make a live action Gundam movie for Netflix coming out soon.
Well, and they got like kaiju directors coming now too.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's not technically anime, but yeah, that looks cool too. Cartoon Network, cartoon. Anime.
And then what, live action Dexter's Lab, is that going to happen?
That'd be cool. Oh, but I mean, granted, I'd be down with that. But like, especially with like Japanese anime, like, I mean, we're in our lifetime, we're going to be able to see like a $1 billion Dragon Ball Z movie.
Maybe we can do a live action Ed, Edd n Eddy or a live action Johnny Bravo.
I'm talking anime, not cartoon cartoons.
Live action Cat Dog.
Cat Dog. SpongeBob. Yeah.
Live action Angry Beavers.
Wow. Johnny Bravo would not be able to exist at all in the modern day.
That's true.
he would
hey, fucking, pretty mama.
Yeah, he would just be thrown in jail immediately.
That's the movie. It's like 1 minute long. Johnny,
someone does a Me Too about Johnny Bravo, and bam, he's in jail. Like, goodbye, Johnny Bravo. That dude series did not hold up in the modern day. But Dexter would be great.
Oh man,
and I love Ed and Eddy. Anyway, anime Dragon Ball Z. I totally think there's gonna be like $1 billion anime, a Dragon Ball Z movie, a live action, and like, yeah, there's so much things pulled. They're working on Cowboy Bebop.
Oh, that'll be cool. They should do a live action Samurai Champloo.
Yeah, and Samurai Jack. And this is gonna be the new wave. There's gonna be Miyazaki films, probably gonna be, you know, like,
oh man, adapted. Live action Porco Rosso.
Yeah. Porco Rosso, Sailor Moon, Tenchi Muyo, Yu Yu Hakusho.
I'm picking out all the weirdest ones I can, but yeah.
Outlaw Star, you name it. I truly believe, because
live action Assassination Classroom.
Yeah, exactly. My Hero Academia. The people that grew up with it are guys, women, men our age. I don't know about you guys, but I was super in the closet about anime when I was younger. And because, again, I played sports just to like get by with, you know, all the harassment and bullying took place. But I was so going home and watching Dragon Ball Z and Gundam Wing and all the anime I could. And I did not talk about it, just like I did not talk about my Dungeons and Dragons affinity or my Magic the Gathering affinity and all my other nerdy stuff that I did. But anime was something that like was not cool. And it is so refreshing to know that the people who were in the closet are now like, you know what? Fuck it. We're the filmmakers now. We're going to make this and it's going to be awesome. It's going to be okay. So yeah, just stick that up your behinds, jocks. Anyway,
yeah, I think everyone is like, we've seen the same few movies made over and over and over and over again.
Yeah, with the Marvel movies. Yeah.
Oh yeah, just for ages.
Okay, so here's the thing. I'm so glad that you're mentioning it. I'm so afraid of oversaturation with anime too. You know, I'm excited about it. Live action anime. I'm so afraid of, because dude, I was also like a huge Marvel and DC fan and growing up. Right. And now I'm like, I don't want to see any more of these. Right. Like there's been so many.
And I think I bet what'll happen is it'll go away. It'll fizzle out a little bit, but looking back on it, it'll be exciting still. You know, it's like it had to run its course. And of course, you know, the movie industry is going to take it just a little too far.
Yeah, if it does well, they're just like, we'll just do like 50 million more of these and keep making more. I'm like, no. Luckily, there's a big diversity, though, with anime. There's so many different stories that they can pull from. It's just more of like the anime spirit and style. You know, that's what we can go for. Whereas superheroes, it's like, well, how many, all these guys are kind of the same. You think about it. I mean, even though I loved them growing up, it's like, X-Men was the different, you know, X-Men and Spider-Man and like Batman, I guess, even though I was a big Batman fan, but like, it's kind of the same story over and over.
At this point, why don't you just do origin stories for every single member of the X-Men? We already had the Wolverine movie. Why don't we do like the Nightcrawler solo movie or the Cyclops solo movie?
Dude, Nightcrawler's got a good origin story in Germany. Yeah. Cyclops origin story. Yeah. Yeah.
Honestly, I'd love to see like Cyclops, like his origin story. And it's just like him, like, you know, like, being birthed, and he's just like, oh, he's so adorable, and he opens his eyes
out,
and lasers and just destroys the whole hospital.
Cyclops getting his first glasses at the eye doctor and just burns through him. Whoa, you need Coke bottle glasses.
Yeah. And he meets like an old mentor that he meets in like, you know, an alley. And he falls down and this guy like beats up the people that are trying to like make fun of him. He's like, you have laser eyes. And this
laser
guy teaches
vision,
him.
Laser vision.
I mean, that's a good point because Cyclops had to have killed so many people.
Oh, yeah.
When he first discovered his powers.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Just opening his eyes meant murder.
Right. And then like the lesson of the whole movie is like, close your eyes.
What about a beast origin story?
Close your eyes.
Stop.
Go to sleep, Cyclops, and just wake up.
Oh man.
Don't wake up. Man. Cyclops. Speaking of that, I recently watched a another late side sort, but like I watched an X-Men anime on Netflix. And
X-Men anime.
It's pretty good on Netflix. Anyway, holy shit, we've been talking about anime way too much. I apologize. This is my fault. Let's go back to Minari and talk about our final verdict of the movie, which is our slurps up, slurps down section. Slurps up, folks, means we like it and we recommend the movie, and slurps down means we don't like it and we don't recommend it. And some maybe shades of gray talk in between there. So, Adam, would you like to start us off with your final verdict for Minari?
Yeah, I'll give Minari a huge slurps up. I think this movie is definitely one to certainly check out. And I don't know what else to say that hasn't already been said. Honestly, this movie is truly a realism check in terms of diversity and acceptance for Korean family coming into the States and talking with other people. But it's really a realism check in terms of family struggles, relatability, for sure. That's the biggest thing I think I can say. I think the movie is just very relatable. At least it was for me. I'm not Korean, but I think even not being Korean, it's just very relatable. I think I related from a family perspective. I think it was just, it felt very real for me. And I think a lot of the struggles that the main character was having, along with David, the young boy in the family, and the rest of the family, a lot of it were things that I felt were very relatable, except for drinking pee. Never in my life have I had to drink urine. But other than
that, you're not a grandpa yet, Adam. You don't know what's going to happen.
No, I'm not a grandpa or a grandma or, you know, anything like that. But otherwise, you know, struggling with, you know, finding a job that's going to pay out and things like that, or, you know, struggling with other close relatives or taking care of people and things like that. Just the real struggles you have like that and just making it work. There's times you get it to work. There's times that you have a hard time. And I think just seeing that in this movie, it felt real. It just really felt real. And there were some nice, really comedic elements in this movie. And there were some times where it just really hit dramatically. And as Clark said earlier, and he said there was a time watching this movie that he was crying. I don't think I quite hit that hard to the point of hitting the tears. But it did feel very emotional to me. So, yeah, got to give this one a slurps up. Definitely worth the watch.
Nice, man. I'm going to elute that and say, yeah, big slurps up for me as well. I can't say anything different than what I've been saying, other than just I'll cap it with tremendous story. Also grounded story, even though it's tremendous, very relatable. Actors were all excellent. I love that it was all mostly in Korean and it took place here in America, Southern America, that is, Arkansas. And the relationships, the comedy, the drama, beautiful film. I want more films like this. And yeah, it's great to see Steven Yeung just crushing it, and great actor ever since he's been on Walking Dead. And
it's a Chicago guy, right?
Yeah, he is. Second City guy. Ooh, yeah. Second City Chicago guy. Yeah. He from what I heard, he turned down Second City. Well, he was a per Turco and he got a Walking Dead. And I could be wrong, Second City, if you're listening, I could be wrong about this. Correct me if I'm wrong. I'm not saying it's 100% true, but from what I heard, they were basically like, you know, how dare you quit or whatever. He's like, I got Walking Dead. Like, I'm out. Like, and he's like, they're like, well, you'll basically never work for this again. He's like, okay.
He's like, shh. Yeah, okay, man. I'm going to go be rich.
Yeah. I'm going to go be famous on the Walking Dead, and it's going to launch me forever into Hollywood. So yeah, I'm super happy for Steven Yeung. Go check out that short film too, Naysayer, that he's in. It's on YouTube. It's 8 minutes long. He is a fantastic actor. I hope this launches him into many more leading roles as well. He is so cool, very relatable. He grew up in Michigan too, very Midwestern dude. His parents, I think, I could be wrong, but I think I've heard him on a podcast before talking about his family. I believe his parents are from Korea, but he's not. He's from Michigan. And yeah, you're right, Clark, Chicago guy. So yeah, dude, he's carrying all of us on his shoulders, our success. We're living through him vicariously. We're rooting for him. Go Steven Yeung. Anyway, I can't praise this enough. Also, Just want to also say that I'm really excited for Lee Isaac Chung's future work as well, especially what you just mentioned, Adam, with Your Name. So yeah, big sub stuff for me. Go check Minari if you haven't. It's on iTunes. It's definitely worth the $20 rental. So go ahead and support the film, and let's keep rooting for it as it wins more awards. Clark, what is your final verdict, friend?
Oh, definitely slurps up. Yeah, I love this whole, I mean, we're on a new phase of, like, I feel like more and more movies just being compact and, like, you know, this is like, it's like an indie movie. Like, yeah, $2 million budget, shot in 25 days. And it's just like, you know, it brings the movie down. And it's just so human. And like, if even though it's, you know, about, you know, living in America and trying to support your family, it's just so human with relationships. And it's like, everyone wants the one same thing, but it's also like pitting kind of everybody against each other. And acting is phenomenal. They don't look at each other like the whole movie. Jacob and Monica, there's like two scenes at the end when they like actually look at each other. And it's, you can just feel their tension, and definitely recommend. And ghost, like, we like movies, go support it. $20, like, you'll thank yourself in the future when movies continue to be good because they're supported by people who enjoy them.
Yeah, I totally agree, man. And dude, wouldn't it be cool if, like, on April 25th, when we see the 2021 Oscars, if this wins, then we get, like, I know this is not, well, this is still an American film, but it's like about Korean people. Two films in a row that would win the Oscars. Last year, the Korean people. Last year we had Parasite that won.
Yeah.
And right? That was last year, right?
That was last year.
2020? Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
That was like the beginning of the pandemic. So there's a little blurry for me memory. But yeah, we had Parasite. And then if we had Minari, this, I'm like, yeah, Korean people sweeping the Oscars. It's awesome. So yeah, that'd be really cool if it wins. I think it's nominated for Best Picture, right? Minari?
It is.
Yeah. I'd read that. Yeah, earlier. I was more focused on the performers than I was the actual film. But yeah, that would be so cool if it won. But a lot of good films are up, and a lot of them we've already reviewed, Adam. We've reviewed a lot of the ones that they've already nominated. So we're kind of, we're definitely caught up. So, with that said, so slurps up all around, right? Adam, me, and Clark.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Three slurps up to the sky. Heck yeah. Well, moving on. With that said, we're going to conclude our review of Minari and move into Soto Plug Time. That's right. So Plug Time is when we please ask you to go check out some stuff that we do besides Screen Slurps. We're besties. We love each other. We're bros, but we do other stuff too on our own. And I'll start off by saying a solo plug for me, Dash Gehart, also as DJ, is my upcoming, or sorry, not upcoming, as an old note, current show, D&D show, Dungeons and Dragons actual play show titled Journey Punks. It's on Twitch and on YouTube. We stream every Monday, and also there's going to be various DM study nights, but we have two main shows on it. Well, really a main show and a companion show. The main show is Journey Punks. It's a Dungeons and Dragons show, and it's the main storyline. Then we have a companion talk show called J-Punk Junk. It's kind of podcasty, you know, a little more of a hangout. It's when we actually get to acknowledge the chat, because we don't really get to do that as much during the game. So if you want to ask questions, go J-Punk Junk. You can follow us at twitch.tv/journeypunks. That's twitch.tv/journeypunks. And you can also look us up on YouTube and look at all the past videos. And Adam, what would you like to solo plug, sir?
You can follow me on Twitter, on Instagram, and on SoundCloud at Adam Meisner. I'm also on Twitch at /A Meisner, and I record and I play music. I play original stuff. I play covers. I play whatever you like. You just let me know, and I will record it. I will put it online. Just tell me what kind of stuff you like to hear. I like to play R&B soul music, but that doesn't mean I won't play any other genres for you.
Ooh, yes. And also, spoilers, Adam has composed the theme song for Journey Punks, which will be revealed soon, at least at the time of this recording. And he's a master of music. So hire this man. Clark, what would you like to solo plug, sir?
You can follow me on Instagram. It's at Clark underscore bar underscore. I post some of my shorts up there. We just had a most recent one titled "How's Your Day?" Just got accepted into the Portland Comedy Film Festival.
Ooh, nice.
So excited about that. And it, you can watch it for free on YouTube. Don't tell Portland. But that's in my bio. You can check that out there.
Cool, cool, cool. Awesome. Well, with that said, Adam, can you give me a freestyle rap right now? And I'll give you a word to start off with.
Okay, what word do you want to start?
Dog.
Dog? It's real rap original right there, man.
That's your one syllable word to start your freestyle rap. Dog.
I have to start with it, or I just have to incorporate it?
Do you have to start with dog? Like the first rhyme has to rhyme with dog. And then you can just keep going. Yeah.
Yo. I'm trying to incorporate a beat. Give him a beat.
Yeah, Clark, give him a beat.
Oh, I got you. Here we go.
Yo, what's going on right now, dog? When we're gonna rap on this log, I'm gonna give you a call, my little frog. When we get back on the rapping cog.
Frog.
Rap dog.
Rap dog. That wraps it up for this episode of Screen Slurps. Thanks for listening, everyone.
The sequel
to Cat Dog. To /follow us on social media. We release new episodes every Monday on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and just about everywhere you can find podcasts on the internet. And please be sure to follow and subscribe to us on those platforms. And if you like our show, please give us a nice 5-star review in the Apple Podcasts app. Please do that and recommend us to everyone in your multiverse. It will help the show grow. That's what we want. Grow, grow, grow. So closing out, this is Dash Gerhardt.
I'm Adam Meisner.
And our special guest,
Clark Pavlik. I'm Clark Pavlik. Thanks for having me, guys. Thank you.
Thank you for being on.
What a great time. Oh. What a great time with you, Clark. Thank you so much for being on the show. Okay. Thank you, listeners, for listening to this episode of Green Slurps. Check us out next time. Check out the archives. Keep on slurping it. Slurp it like crazy. What were you saying?
It's episode 50.
Whoa! 50! Episode 50. Heck yeah.
Thanks for being here for 50 episodes.
Now I'm not going to keep mounting eggs. We don't get sued. Anyway, slurps up. We'll catch you later.